Well, first of all, I just wanted to thank you for inviting me here to this workshop. I got so much out of all of our discussions yesterday. Definitely has been very mind-opening for me to be here, and a lot of soul-searching as we go through, saying, we're not that far off, I think, from simulating a billion cells if we want to. We're at 10 to the 4th, easy. 10 to the 5th, not too bad. 10 to the 6th, with some work, even on a single supercomputer node or on a desktop. So, I mean, the leap from there is not horrible. So now is the time to think about what are we going to do with it if we actually can hit this threshold. And that has really caused me to think a lot about, what does modeling mean? What are our goals as modelers? And how do we get this job done right? Or hopefully right. Let's just get the job done, and then we'll see if we get it done right. My mission today is to start thinking about these challenges that we face as a field going forward and what we have to address to get there. So I'd like to start off with just the typical motivation slide I show here. Here's a histologic image from ductal carcinoma in situ of the breast. It is a fairly typical histologic image. Usually I walk around and point when I'm talking, so I guess I'll do that. So here's, a breast duct, and it's completely full of cancer cells. This is a viable rim where there's plenty of oxygen, glucose, and growth substrates to keep those cells alive. And you can see them. And then you have this dead core of necrotic stuff, a necrotic core of dead cells. And it has a fully intact basement membrane. In fact, this is a fairly controversial cancer because some people don't even want to call it cancer for good reasons. If it stays like this forever, it's perfectly safe to the patient. You can live with this for the rest of your life. But the problem is that on some patients, and we don't know which patients, the cells don't stay in the duct. They break through the basement membrane and they leave. And you can start seeing hints of that in this histologic image here. You have your necrotic core, you have your viable rim. That's forming because there's no blood vessels inside the duct. You can only get there by blood vessels outside the duct, and the stroma supplying oxygen, glucose, and it diffuses into the duct, and eventually you hit the diffusion limit, and you don't have enough to keep the cells alive and get the dead core. Now, dead stuff seems to secrete factors that attract an immune response, and so you get clusters of lymphocytes and other immune cells that start wandering around the duct. There are probably fibroblasts hidden all throughout this structure that are remodeling the tissue in response to signals both from the immune system and from the tumor cells. And the system of cells is interacting in a very complicated way that sometimes leads to cancer progression and sometimes doesn't. So we have a very complicated stuff all in one picture here. A lot of processes, biomechanics, transport, evolution, phenotypic adaptation to microenvironmental changes, gradients of transport species, all in one picture. So our job of modelers is to try to come up with systems that help us detangle these complicated pictures and make sense of it and hopefully give insights to clinicians. And so, the goal of going forward here is, at least in the near term, develop mechanistic 3D simulation systems to help us make sense of pictures like this and to get predictive models. And then in the long term, start giving tools to clinicians and biologists to help them to make either to plan experiments or to make long-term decisions on what to do with the treatment choices. That might be me, I'm sorry. So at least it's away. So to do that, one of the things we've been doing is developing a large agent-based model like many of you here. You saw some of this yesterday in Farzan's talk. But the goal is just to say, I want to do some really basic physics, cells sticking together, pushing each other around, moving around in a three-dimensional microenvironment, sampling the microenvironment, making phenotypic changes based upon the microenvironmental sampling, which are driven by data given to us by collaborators, for example, high-content microscopy, high-throughput screening. And we put these together and just say, I have basic rules for individual agents, and I have a model of the microenvironment. How do those systems interact to form emergent predictions, like growth rates, size of a tumor, whether it metastasizes or not, and what kind of rules do we need to put in to make this thing work? So we have some agent-based model that we've been developing, like all of you have been doing, and we're getting bigger and bigger in the scales of things that we can do. So what are the bottlenecks to get this done? So this motivates me, and I think it motivates a lot of us, and now let's start kind of sampling the challenges. So I've been classing the barriers that we face into several. And so when I started preparing for this, I've thought, like most computational people, let's talk about the computational challenges. But as I did my soul searching in the last several months and even the last day or so, there are more than just computational challenges. There are data and scientific challenges, there are cultural challenges, and there are tools challenges facing us. And so computational challenges are the least of our worries. I mean, they're a big part of it, but we're not so far off in them. So, you know, one of the first challenges that we all have faced is the fact that all these agent models are potentially order n squared in computational cost. You have n cells, which need to interact with at most n minus one other cells. So examples include mechanics. If you're not very clever about it, you have to test for interactions with all the other agents, which doesn't scale terribly well. Also, signaling communication. I mean, if you're doing the most general possible model, every cell could possibly in some way communicate in some way with every other possible cell. That's not good. So just looking at the cost of it, imagine you have some kind of a function you have to compute, and each function depends upon all the other cells. You add up the cost to it, and you get order n squared to make that happen. So that's kind of not good. So suppose that you have some kind of a simulation that takes you, let's suppose that you have a great model and you can simulate a million cells in one day. So what does it take to get to a billion cells? Well, it increases your 1,000 increase in cell count increases your computational cost by a factor of a million. So if you can do it one day for a million cells, you only have to wait 2,700 years to do a billion cells. That's not a really great, well, you know, you can do like a generational ship and you can start it off and then, you know, let your great, 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 great grandchildren inherit the answer when you're done. I guess that kind of worked for the answer is 30, whatever, you know, 32, thank you. But yes, you guys are trying to throw me off. But it's not very feasible. Well, you can be a little clever and say, oh, well, you know, Newton likes equal and opposite interactions. So if you compute the interaction between cell and I and J, you've already got the interaction between J and I. All right. Well, that cuts your cost in half. So now you only have to increase your computational effort by 500,000. So now you only have 1,400 years of work. You've saved an entire millennium of work. That's great, but it's not enough to get us there. So you have to be more clever. And this has been solved pretty well. So most of us who've gotten up to the scale have already looked at this. You know, the fact of the matter is that most cells don't interact infinitely over infinite distances. There's some kind of a finite maximum deformation of cells and a finite maximum mechanical interaction. And if you build the right data structures to truncate those operations, now you can really cut down on your work. And so if you divide space up in some way and write up a list of possible interactions in each physical location, now this list becomes truncated. It's all the cells in your nearby list. And so if your list has a bounded number of maximum neighbors, now you've got an order n operations. So increasing by a factor of 1,000 increases your work by a factor of 1,000. So looking at the difference, you know, blue curve, cut your in half, then cut it by, you know, three orders of magnitude, you can't even see the difference. So let's go log scale. You can see a tremendous difference in the effort. So now your simulation only takes you a couple of years. Well, that's certainly better than a couple of millennia. That's progress. And, you know, if you're clever and do the equal opposite thing, now it's only about a year. So you've turned a multi-generational problem into a really painful graduate problem. So that's definitely progress. But it's not enough to get the job done yet. But you can see that, you know, we've been facing computational challenges just by being clever about our algorithms and about our testing and not brute forcing our way through all the time. We can make these things possible. And, you know, as a field, I think we've done a nice job of getting there. Signaling is similar. You know, at the end of the day, unless you're modeling neurons, okay, that's another matter, right? But for most of the problems that we've been working on, say cancer, signaling, most of the signaling is by chemical substrates. And so if you turn your problems into that, cells secrete some kind of chemical substrate, well, that's a cost that's order n. Each cell has to do the same thing. And then you have to do diffusion through domain. That's basically a cost that scales with your domain size instead. And then you have n cells that have to sample the microenvironment. Well, that's order n. So this becomes order n instead of order n squared for most kinds of communication you do. So maybe it's no accident that a lot of cells communicate by chemical signals. It seems to be a lot cheaper. Also, it's a lot more biologically realistic. So for that kind of communication, it's not too bad. That's basically solved by doing diffusion problems. And then, you know, in terms of contact-based, you know, communication, well, you can take advantage of your mechanics testing structure. Say, I already know who's nearby. I don't have to test all n minus one cells. I can just test the guys in my neighborhood for contact, and you can do whatever inhibition you might have. Say, DLL4 notch signaling for endothelial cells, for example, or contact inhibition for proliferation, mechanical stresses, things like that. Now that's basically again back to order n. So order n squared cell interactions is basically a solved problem, I think. It's just a matter of implementing it efficiently. So already as a field, we've come a long ways on facing these bottlenecks. So, you know, putting one challenge out now, this one is, let's start with a simple challenge, one that I think we can all solve pretty well, biotransport. To do cell-cell interaction well, you have to do many diffusing substrates in really large 3D volumes. There are many ways to solve this problem. The dumbest way you can do it is by explicit finite differences, because of a really tiny time step restriction to get stable and efficient and accurate computations. So the first thing you can do is turn it into implicit operation so it's stable. But now you have a humongous matrix system to invert, which has been solved, but is difficult to implement well and doesn't always scale well to humongous problems easily, certainly not for all of us. But there are also many, many things you can do on that. Green's functions are great, but you basically turned it back into order n squared problem because you're evaluating a bunch of point source functions for a bunch of point source uptakes. So that doesn't scale nicely, although it looks beautiful when you see them. So the challenge is to develop transport algorithms that scale well, make full use of your CPU capabilities depending on your architecture, scales to many billions of sources and sinks, and is flexible enough to add in new biology and add in new substrates. The last thing you want is to say, if I add 15 more substrates, it takes you another 15 times the amount of cost to simulate it. So we've worked on this a little bit, and we're happy to share our code later this year. We took a very simplistic approach of first doing operator splitting and solving the these individual terms with independent solvers that are all implicit and stable and things like that. And then for the diffusion term, we do locally one-dimensional, which lets you do a massively parallel bunch of Thomas algorithms. You can pre-compute things like the forward sweeps, you can trade memory for speed, and all of a sudden, you can do all your X diffusion at once, all your Y diffusion at once, all your Z diffusion at once, split off all those different Thomas solvers to all your different cores. You get more cores, you get faster automatically. It's not too bad. This order accuracy is order delta t in space and time, order delta x squared in space. It's good enough for most of what we want right now. And it scales well with number of substrates. If you go from one substrate to 10, you only increase your work by a factor of about 2.5. And we tried to break it, and we went up to 100 substrates on 1 million voxels for 60 minutes. And it was approaching basically real time, 60 minutes to simulate 60 minutes of diffusion on a desktop. So that's, with Moore's law number of cores, it's actually scaling okay. And so if we're in that 5 to 10 regime where many biological problems are right now, it's actually pretty feasible. So let's get to harder computational challenges. Now, we want to make sure that we're not limited by our computational power. So how do we leverage what we have? And so the problem we've all been facing is that the problems are computationally big. How do we make use of our computational resources? So the traditional approach is to take your problem and split it up into a bunch of different computers and have some kind of a coordinating computer or a traffic controller farm out your work to different compute nodes and eventually, every now and then, assemble the results and then send out the next wave of computation. And that's more or less been the paradigm of supercomputers and clusters, is to have a head node and compute nodes that bundle up the work and send it out where it belongs with some kind of communication between the nodes to trade the boundary data. It's a distributed memory model, which means that no one of these green compute nodes has access to the entire problem. So it's very much up to the head node to distribute the information that's needed. Don't know what I did there. Okay. So that has a lot of benefits. In particular, you can increase the computing power just by adding more nodes to an extent. And the typical problem you have is you often run basically the same code on all of your nodes, and it's just rely upon dividing up your problem nice, either spatially or in some other way. Drawbacks of this approach, first of all, they're really hard to implement well. You have to worry about what happens on the boundaries of your little subdomains on the different compute nodes. And you have a latency problem, right? You have a lot of data to shuffle between nodes, so if you're not clever about it, you spend all your time waiting for your network instead of actually computing. And there comes a point where if you add more and more nodes, you haven't increased your computing power anymore. You've spent more and more and more of your time on network communication rather than on getting work done. So that has a kind of a diminishing return. But it works really well, and BioSelium people have really proved that, I think. But it's one approach. More recently, you can use graphics cards, because graphics cards now are basically massively parallel machines. Lots of compute streams or cores on them. They have, I think, thousands of cores, like 2,000 cores on a typical K20, I think, or K40. That was been a fun story. At the beginning, people just figured, hey, I can turn my problem into a shading and lighting problem and trick the graphics card into doing it for me. It's really clever. We got some really cool stuff done. Now they've basically become computing devices with CUDA and OpenCL. You can do this a little bit nicer. And another nice benefit is they have a pretty good amount of memory on the card and a shared memory. That means every core has access to the entire problem. So this latency problem is a lot smaller now. Now you're limited to the memory speed of your individual graphics card rather than the network speed. So that's going to be an orders of magnitude faster communication. So that tapering off slows, is a lot less of a problem. So benefits, you know, very specialist hardware. These things are really fast. So if you got the right problem and if it maps onto the hardware world, you're in great shape. It, of course, also has drawbacks. First, you know, latency. If your problem doesn't fit on the graphics card memory, now you have to communicate over the bus and trade things back and forth between main memory. That's still relatively slow, a little faster than a gigabit network, but still relatively slow. Other problems is they may not be fully general computing machines. So if you have a complicated model, let's say you have full JKR mechanics, it may or may not work on this simple thing. So simple agent's going to work great. I have my concerns that it won't actually scale well for really biologically relevant agents. And then lock-in. To do it well on an NVIDIA card, you have to use CUDA, not OpenCL. Now you're locked into CUDA. And it's such a specialized code, now you're developing two codes, your CPU code and your graphics code, and you've doubled your amount of maintenance work to make use of graphics cards. So you have to basically make a decision. Do I do graphics card or I do CPU? You get graphic card mains, but now only people with really great graphics cards can ruin your codes. So there's that trade-off. We haven't decided to take that plunge yet just because of these issues. Then there's a third approach, which has been more and more feasible over the last few years with multi-core CPUs. Most CPUs, in fact, most Moore's Law growth has been adding cores to your computer rather than making the cores faster. So you're still following that 18-month transistor count, but now the transistors are spent on more cores for more parallelism. So you need to take advantage of that to get your computational gains. So you divide your work among the cores. In fact, here's the beast that I saw on Intel's site. 18 cores, 36 threads on one really nice Xeon. I want one of these things. But you know, they're getting to ridiculous numbers of cores on CPUs now. Again, this is a shared memory architecture, and the support for OpenMP is built into most modern compilers, so you don't have to do much to get there. It's very low-hanging fruit. So for an example, this little loop of for int I from 0 to number of cells do some ungodly amount of work, now gets an extra pragma at the top that decides to split it among all of my cores, all of my threads, which I specified to be 8 here. So for very little work, in theory, OpenMP is very easy. Now, the problem is the drawbacks. So you still have latency from your memory. Scaling, you know, once you're up to your number of cores, you can't scale any further. You have to buy a better computer. You can't just add nodes now to improve it. And there are a lot of gotchas to be careful with when you do OpenMP. It may turn out that you're accessing data structures and modifying them in your loop in a way that basically blows it up and you get a segmentation fault by the time you're through your loop. You have to be really careful with that. Pseudorandom number generators often have little static internal variables that are used in the function call, so you have to call them serially, not in parallel. So you have to be really careful about what you do. I run into interesting things with string toke in parsing. I'm really sorry about my phone. It's irritating. So there are gotchas you have to be careful with. But if you do it, it scales really nicely. So we use that in all of our codes now. So the challenge is to how do you leverage these different architectures to really start getting you your compute power? And so MPI does some things well. It scales the number of nodes really well. It can add capacity very nice, but it has latency and complexity. OpenMP is easy to write, but once you reach the limits of your node, you're done. Graphics cards are really specialized, but are potentially very powerful, and you have lock-in. So, and this is, I think, what BioCellian does in a lot of the higher-end codes, is take a hybrid approach. On your individual compute nodes, you use OpenMP. So the first thing you do on any code is you make the absolute best use of your compute node as you can, and then you network it with MPI and divide your problem up. And then perhaps if you're a little bit more clever, I'm not that clever, but if someone is, then you leverage the GPU on each of your compute nodes to do some specialized work. So I would suggest that you don't do the agents on your GPU, but do something simpler but standardized, like the diffusion solving on your GPUs on each node, because that's just a bunch of Thomas algorithms. That is linear algebra. That's exactly what graphics cards are made for. So do your diffusion on the graphics cards, do the agents with your OpenMP, do MPI to coordinate the effort between all these nodes. Now you can scale pretty big. So if you're doing 10 to the 6, 10 to the 5, or 10 to the 6 on individual nodes, and you've got a supercomputer with 10 to the 3 nodes, you're looking at 10 to the 9th territory. So with the techniques we have out there, we're not that far off. But those are probably not the biggest barriers that we're facing. We have scientific and data barriers to think about. So first of all, calibration initialization. You know, the issue is we have agent models that are incredibly detailed. They have things all the way from the molecular scale, like different protein states and cell phenotype state, how far you are in the cell cycle progression, what's the volume of your individual cells, what's their water content. I mean, all of these things times 10 to the 9th, you know, do you have that much data to even properly initialize a model and get it going? And, you know, whereas the typical data right now are often more population scale. What's the distribution of cell phenotype? What's the distribution of cell sizes? So somehow you have to initialize your very detailed model with coarse-grained data with some kind of a proper statistical distribution of properties so that you're at least consistent with the problem. Now, that's getting better and better all the time. We've heard wonderful, encouraging news somewhere from this side of the room from engineering saying that imaging tendon-line cells is starting to move along. I've been hearing that from my collaborators, too. So we're going to at least get to some basic data sets. So this is going to improve, but you're still going to face that problem of your details will almost inevitably be more detailed than your calibration data. So how do you, you know, do this? So I guess that would be my next challenge here. The problem, you have discrete models with lots of very detailed state information that you need to initialize, and you have experimental data that are not as detailed. How do you develop proper initialization techniques that make the absolute most use of your individual data and cell tracking information, and then fill in the missing pieces, perhaps by a little bit more clever image analysis? People do angiogenesis algorithms in vascular networks look at this all the time. You don't just have number of endothelial cells, you have their arrangement, you have the branch length, you have the branching density, the vessel thicknesses, extra statistical properties of those networks that help you come up with a reasonably consistent vascular network that really looked like a histological specimen. So how do we use that population information and get higher order statistics that really help us to map on and get a good initial distribution, and then save that information so that other people can use it? So, and then the other thing is, we have stochastic models with some kind of a generated tissue, which is kind of statistically consistent, but not necessarily exactly consistent. How many runs do you have to do to get a meaningful scientific result? You know, and I think it depends on what you're trying to draw out. If you want a growth rate, probably the stochastic properties average out by the time you get to 10 to the 6th or 10 to the 9th. So maybe you only need one run. But if you're doing other things like cell distributions and positional information relationships, you probably do have to do a lot of simulation runs. So actually, now you need to do, what, 10 to the 12th cells. It's just serially. So that's worth thinking about. The next barrier to think about is validation. So suppose you have this wonderful model, and you simulate out, and you have 10 to the 9th cell positions at a whole bunch of times. What do you validate against? Because again, you get down to the same measurement limitations. You have a coarse sampling of time of a limited number of variables, which are going to probably not validate every single component of your model. And so, and particularly you have stochastic models, so you're not going to be able to match up individual cell positions to validate them. So you're looking at some kind of emergent properties for validation. What does that mean? Does that mean you've really validated your model, or have you validated some coarse-grained version of your model? You know, I think it requires a little bit of thinking of what does it mean to actually validate a stochastic model. And so the challenge, develop a better notion of what it means to validate a stochastic model. What has to match in what sense? In a distributional sense, on an average sense? In mean cell positions, in some kind of an emergent statistics sense, what are the right metrics to measure to say that your model is doing the right thing? You know, you have to do that before you even start worrying about comparing models and saying which model is better. Related challenge, and then, is to come up with good benchmark data sets. Now that the measurement techniques are coming along, I think a good grand challenge would be to say, let's come up with some really good validation and calibration validation data sets that let us start calibrating and validating models. Things like, at least let's start with the basic information, like cell positions, whether they're alive or they're dead, the cell volumes, maybe at 4 or 5 different times. And then you have to get enough of this to have both a calibration replicate, you know, set and a validation set, so that you don't say that you've proved your model by saying you matched your training set, which was another big problem in computational biology for a long time. You had a lot of modeling papers that didn't differentiate between training and validation. So you have to be really careful on this. So that gets us saying, suppose now we have enough to calibrate models. Well, suppose that we can do the model. We have enough to calibrate it. We have enough to validate it. But we still have the problem that we discussed a lot yesterday. What do you do with 10 to the 9th cells? And so we kind of look backward a little bit. Let's kind of unwind a bit and say, you know, when we got to different scales of simulation, what did we gain at each scale? At 10 to the 3rd cells in 3D, you're looking at about 200 microns. That's big enough to start seeing gradients, but not big enough when you're doing spherical. You're not going to see big necrotic cores and things like that. But you did see enough for clonal dynamics and selection. So it was really great for evolutionary people in particular. So 10 to the 3rd got us something neat. Great for stem cell models, for example. You get stem cell niches and things like that. 10 to the 4th, you've basically doubled in size. That's big enough to start seeing gradients and substrates and oxygen, glucose, stuff like that. You can do some good tumor microenvironment interaction modeling at that scale. 10 to the 5th to 10 to the 6th, now you're getting to the millimeter scale. That's definitely big enough to do something that's like clinically feasible. And there's another bonus. That's big enough to start overlapping with the continuum regime. So now you can start talking about model matching. And how do you coarse grain from a discrete model to a continuum model, you know, either with a theoretical matching or even just saying, do a whole lot of material studies on discrete models and say, I'm going to use that to drive constitutive relations for my continuum models. So you have this wonderful place where you can kind of overlap, and it's like a relay race. Now you can pass the baton to the continuum model and let them take you up to 10 to the 9th, to 10 to the 12th, and 10 to the 15th, or whatever you need to do. 10 to the 15th would be really big. But this is enough to start doing some really detailed tumor stroma dynamics and really detailed modeling. So 10 to the 9th, that basically takes up to about the 2-centimeter range. So what I love is 10 to the 6th, something you can actually see. I love that, to be able to say, guess what, I simulated something this big. 10 to the 6th, you can see it in the back of the room. I'm sorry, 10 to the 9th now, you can see it in the back of the room. You're about 2-centimeter scale for, you know, 20 micron scales. But most of the emergent dynamics are about the same as 10 to the 6th. If you get the growth rate up to 10 to the 6th, it's going to be fairly similar at 10 to the 9th. There are some problems where it makes sense. You get a good chunk of liver. If you're doing a mouse, you can do an entire liver. So that's something we learned yesterday. You could probably do an entire expanded lymph node. So lymph node metastases is probably a good problem. But, you know, or maybe an entire mouse organ. But, you know, you have to decide what that problem is. But what you almost need is 10 to the 12th. Now you can do an entire big cancer in a lung. So 10 to the 9th is kind of this weird no man's land where you're between big enough to get predictions but too small enough to do really something hugely clinically useful. And you're now talking about simulating a year of progression rather than a month or so. So, you know, you need to scale up more than just your order n. You need order n times another factor of efficiency so you can get a year of simulation done in a feasible time. So this is worth a lot of thought. What are the key problems? So the challenge is, what is the killer app for 10 to the 9th cells? Many predictions emerge at 10 to the 5th, 10 to the 6th cells. Many of the problems we want to do require 10 to the 12th. I don't know when we're going to get there. That one scares me. So the challenge is to find what is that killer app to do it. So there was a lot of discussion yesterday. I think people found some of those killer apps. But you really have to think hard about this and identify, is your problem appropriate at 10 to the 9th cells, or should you make that switch to a continuum model? And can you detect, kind of automatically, when have I crossed that threshold when I should stop bothering 10 to the 9th cells and make the switch to a continuum model? Is it just a matter of looking at statistics and look at when they stop looking wiggly? I mean, maybe it's as simple as that. But it's worth some thought to say, when do I use one model framework and when do I use another, and how do I hybrid them together so I can leverage the strengths of both? A related problem is biological hypotheses. You know, this one I just threw in this morning. 10 to the 3 cells is already enough to do C. elegans. There are only 1,000 cells in a worm. And yet, most of us, if we put 10 to the 3 cells into our code, are not going to get a nice wiggly worm. So this is the Open Worm Project, right? They looked at neural networks of worms, and they actually built those rules into, I think, Lego Mindstorms, and they got a nice wiggling Lego that actually responded to stimuli. It was really cool. But you needed the emergent rules. You needed extra layers on top of just having 10 to the 3 cells to get a worm instead of a small tumor. So you needed something a little more. 10 to the 9th to 10 to the 10th cells give you a whole mouse, but without any rules of the systems of the circulation and the signaling and, you know, the lung and fluid transport, all you do is get a mouse-sized tumor. You know, that's cool, but it doesn't get you much. 10 to the 13th to 10 to the 14th is enough to do a human being. But again, without some extra systems on top and an organizational concept, you've just got a human-sized lump of tumor. So this starts getting kind of silly. So, you know, we need to think, you know, get to a point where our biological hypotheses have to catch up with our modeling capability. Otherwise, we're just doing really big tumors. But simulations can help with this. So this is the flip side, too. If you can simulate this number of cells, you can start thinking about what it takes to go from a lump of junk to an organized, orderly system. So embryonic development is a great place to think about that. Another great challenge, suppose you can do all this, you can model things. We still have a problem of data interoperability right now. Interoperability is right now not interoperable. So you run into this case of really lots of duplicated work. Modeling group one wants to model some cancer. And so they go and they meet up with some biologists and they mine the literature and they come up with their own parameter values that map up onto their own individual model, simulate, save the results, usually as a bunch of pretty pictures and some tables that are embedded in their paper, unmineable, undiscoverable, and they move on. And then modeling group two says, oh, I'd like to model that too. They read the literature, do some custom experiments that are incompatible with group one, and they can't even read group ones because they didn't write down, you know, cell cycle time scale. They wrote down parameter alpha 32 in their model, in their table. So they can't reuse any of that work. And they write it down in their own weird way and simulate and get it done. And then group three, who happens to be, you know, another graduate student group with group two, wrote their own identical framework, but they can't use parameter values from the other one because they decide, oh, you know, I'm going to use a vertex model instead of a cell-centered model, and I have alpha 37C. You know, and so you get this weird duplication of effort, and you have the same, a bunch of groups doing the same thing over and over and over again. And so without some kind of data interoperability, we can't, you know, learn from one another and share our insights and stop duplicating this work. So a challenge is the data standards challenge. I think that model representation and data representation are kind of two complementary problems. And so things like the cell behavior ontology have done a fantastic job of saying, how do I represent different possible cell and model behaviors and represent them in a way that's discoverable to say, I know what this model does because I have the data tags. I know what this model does, I have the data tags. I might even be able to start plugging them together. That's very important, but also you just need a representation of the data, because we may not ever agree on how to represent all models, but we can at least agree on our inputs and our outputs and how we represent cell phenotype. That's something we can probably agree on a little bit earlier. There are only so many ways to say cell cycle. There are only so many ways to say cell death and cell size. We could probably agree on some of these things. Because if we can do that, we can start pooling our efforts and creating repositories of parameter values that are more than just bio-number searchable things that turn up only one parameter for C. elegans. I'd like to know, you know, what's the cell cycle timescale and hypoxia for breast cancer cells? And how does that differ from cell cycle timescale for colon cancer cells in hypoxia or normoxia or in a drug combination? And so that's the challenge. Now, this is one that we've actually been working on, and we would love to have help from you guys here. So we have a project called Multicell DS, a data standard for multicellular systems. And we're focusing more on the data than we are on the model description. And so what we found is that a lot of data efforts have focused on the subcellular scale. SPML, you know, GO, PharmML says, I can describe systems really well up until one cell. But we're like the inverse of that. It's like the whole you know, conformal mapping from inside a sphere to outside a sphere. We want to go from one cell to many cells and not worry so much about what's going on inside of them for a while, or just embed SPML in all our cells if we feel like it. So how do we get some kind of representation? And so we've been trying to do this. We have a project that's been going for about 2 years now. We're moving towards publication later this year. And we have two main data types. We have digital cell lines that basically collect phenotype measurements with microenvironmental context and put them into a repository of many different digital cell types so they can start getting parameter values and pooling our efforts. I'll skip past it, but the idea is to record, as a function of microenvironmental context, phenotype in some kind of a standardized representation and store it away, multiple phenotype, you know, profiles for multiple conditions, and call it a cell line. And so you store this away, and then you have a similar thing for a snapshot. You say, I know what cell types are in my simulation. I have my digital cell lines. And my snapshot says, where are all my cells and what are their current phenotypes? You know, where am I in my cell cycle? Am I alive or am I dead? What's my elapsed time? What's my position? What's my volume? You can save a dump of that information in a very systematic, orderly way. And if everyone saves it in the same way, we can start comparing models and combining them to ensembles. So that's going to be a really nice thing to do. So, you know, you can save all of your information, microenvironment information, discrete elements like blood vessels, or your cell positions, any continuum variables. This can all go into one snapshot and can save it away. So we've actually been trying to build a repository of this. So we already have a repository of about 50 digital cell lines, 17 of them from ductal carcinoma in situ, another 38 of them that are based on HCC data. It's kind of like wiki stubs where we have basic birth and death conditions in normoxia. And these are the intention is that these are curated, that over time there's a data owner for each one of these digital cell lines that looks out for advances in measurements and starts adding them in so that these lines get maintained and improved over time. Estimated parameters get replaced with directly measured parameters. Directly measured parameters get replaced with more accurate parameters. And so the idea is that all of these get quality controlled and improved over time, so you have different versions of them. So we can put our effort into sharing these values in a systematic way rather than measuring the basic parameters over and over and over again. So that would be a really good thing. So now the problem is this is very manually curated right now. So another challenge is data capture. So what we'd like to be able to do is say, I have a microscope that measures, you know, images, basically, at different times feed that into image processing pipelines that segments it and turns it into digital objects and puts them into a snapshot. And then based upon time series of that and different stains, put them through system identification toolboxes and extract out the phenotype parameters. And now you say, I can start with my snapshot of images and turn it into a digital cell line, and also a bunch of starting snapshots to say, here's what I would actually configure a simulation to start as. Here's my first picture, and hey, I have a bunch of snapshots, so I have my validation data all ready to go. So that would be a great thing to start doing for models. So I guess the challenge is to start interfacing software with instruments so they can start doing this automatic capture and also capture the metadata. You know, if the user puts in their ORCID ID, then we know who created the data, and it gets embedded, and they get the proper credit and, you know, maybe blame, right, depending upon the experimental setup, and that tracks along. So if you can do that, we can start getting really nice pipelines between data and experiments. And that's, you know, that's like the discussion we had this morning with, I think, Paul Allen's project. You need really great microscopy and experiments. You need great image processing and feature extraction. You need a way to write down your data. You can't do big data until you can write it down. And you need to store it in a repository of some kind so you can share the results and make use of them. And then once you have that, starting a big simulation is not as big of a deal. You have your donor tissues, your digital snapshots. You have your digital cell lines that give you the, so you have the snapshot that tells you where your cells are, digital cell lines that give you the dynamical parameters. You combine those together and you have enough to start a dynamical simulation. You simulate, you save into kind of a standard format, your math analysis, put it back into the repository. Now we can start doing some bigger and better things and start worrying about doing this little piece over and over and over again individually for each project. There are cultural barriers that we have as a field to face. This one's more funny because we all have done this. Perfectionism is a barrier that we all face. Consider, you know, a classic problem. I have algorithm one that's second order accurate, and algorithm two that's only first order accurate, and method one is really fast, takes maybe 5 days to do a good simulation at some reasonable quality, and method two takes me 20 days. Which one wins? By the traditional sense, in all of our training, we've gone through triple E journals, math journals, definitely algorithm one. But we're in the real world where we have milestones. Method one took me 10 months and I had a 6-month milestone, and I don't get data until 9 months. Algorithm two took me only 2 months and it takes longer, but you tell me which one made more data, which one got me more scientific progress, which one let me move on to doing something more interesting scientifically. So we have to face these kinds of barriers and make sure we have the right culture. The culture of finding a winning model is another problem I really worry about. Within the scope of our experimental uncertainty, most of our models give about the same results. Instead of looking for a winning model, we ought to be combining them together into ensemble models, stop putting them in competition, having them leverage one another to get uncertainty quantification and more accurate predictions. The hurricane people do this all the time. There's no such thing as a winning model, and we have a danger of forming a software monoculture that's going to be defeated by one resistant problem. And so we have to think about that and get away from that idea of saying, my model's bigger, better, faster, whatever, and just say, let's try to get them to work together so we can get in ensembles. And so the idea there is then if you had compatibility and high throughput data, you can actually start doing that. And, you know, that's what the hurricane people do, standard inputs, 5 or 6 independent models, maybe more. Standardized outputs, put them together, and now you've got your cone of uncertainty and you can improve your predictions more reliably. We need an open culture that makes this thing possible. We need to get people thinking about contributing data, contributing models, adding to repositories, and not being afraid to open up, if not their code, at least their results. So we can start improving and validating and cross-validating models and then putting them together. So that's a cultural change, and I think that's very much happening. The very fact that we're here today and working together shows me that this cultural shift is happening, and I'm really excited. You know, 5, 10 years ago, it was harder to get people to do this, but it's really coming along. So, and then we need to make sure that the scientific culture catches up with that. A digital cell line is a weird thing. You've got value from people who provide the data and the measurements. You have value from people who curate it and do quality control. You have value from people who come up with better image processing protocols and better analyses and add refinements. And all of these people need to get credit both for academic honesty and just for incentivization. Who's going to provide help to other people if they're basically stomped all over and their results are not properly attributed and it's used to get some beautiful, magical, large result? You need an academic culture and even a citation style that can kind of credit an aggregation effort in the proper way. So you know, we're trying to build that into our data element itself to suggest the attribution. This is digital selling created by person one with version done by person two using data elements from here and contributions through these following papers so that everything gets embedded and tracked along. But you have to think about these things if we want people to play together. Tool barriers, just moving really quickly. Right now, we have a problem with lousy tools. Everyone has their own data standard, which means that everyone has to write their own calibration tools, validation tools, and processing tools. So we're spending all our time on visualizations and nothing on the in-depth analysis. You know, what are the correlations between functions, between cells? What are the two-point correlations? What are the correlations between microenvironment gradients and cell positions? Everyone has to keep inventing their own tools over and over again. So they end up being fairly shallow tools that don't get reused. And they're buggy, and they only get so far. If we can all agree on a data type, we can just start pooling our efforts on a few really good tools. So you have, and that's going to help our cross-training students. Now a student can just configure with one tool, and they can run 15 models and go back and forth. You don't get that lock-in anymore. I think that was a topic, was that, I think, in your talk yesterday, right? That you get this problem of lock-in, because the harder a tool is to use, the more you get locked in. But if you can use the same front-end tool for many tools, you get around that problem. Game editors have done this, right? You draw out your microenvironment, you add in your players. So here's your digital snapshot, here are your digital cell lines, and you let it loose. And people can trade levels, or people can trade tissues, people can trade players or AIs, right? If you have some kind of way of editing, I think you can do some really cool things. Maybe that garage science starts playing in. So I'd like to see graphical configurators where you draw in a tissue or import it from a segmented tissue and adding your players and send it out to your simulators. We tried it, but we weren't quite ready to do it when we tried it a few years ago. I think the collective experience in this room could do this really well, and it would have an immense impact. Then on the flip side, I'd like to see visualization tools too. I want to see Fantastic Voyage for our data. I want to fly my little mini sub through my scene and look around. I want to fly through my blood vessels and extravasate and see what cells are there. I want to set my clipping planes with my little flying sub and then send it out to Pavre for rendering. Instead of right now, I mean, Pavre, the hardest pain in the rear on that is figuring out where to put your camera in the angle and the up angle. I mean, that's horrible. And then putting clipping planes. It's a horrible process. It makes pretty plots, but it takes forever. So that's, I think, our challenge, to make, you know, user-friendly tools that we can share for configuration, data exploration, and post-processing. And then the last barrier I want to talk about is just how do we start combining these tools and these models in a meaningful way? We have lots of different models and lots of different languages. Even if we have the same data language, they have to work together. So the last challenge, and I didn't know how many N I would have on challenges when I was writing my slides out, so challenge N. Codes have different things. If we just rely on file I/O for model interchange, it's going to be slow. So we need to get around that. I'd like to think of something like a breadboard, where you plug in different modules. So we should have data parsers to bring it in. We should dump it into some kind of a shared memory in the center. And then you should start plugging in modules that maybe communicate through some kind of a traffic cop to trade, you know, and update these globally shared structures. It might be kind of like MPI. Might be kind of like Babel, something like that. But we need some way to kind of plug into a common framework and not worry about linking codes and modules and things like that. So I think some kind of a client-server object, you know, model might work for that. But I don't know how to do that. I would like to see the collective experience here come up with that. So I'd like to just acknowledge my group for their help in this work. I have two wonderful postdocs, one of whom is here and been working on image processing and data analysis and also all of our models, agent and transport. We have some medical students and undergraduates who have helped kind of test out ideas and move it along. We have wonderful colleagues and collaborators. Shannon here is my main partner in crime for getting biological data, and it's been wonderful working with her. Also, we have a tremendous panel of reviewers, many of whom are here today for the multi-cell DS effort, who have really helped push along the data standard and improve the process. And that, by the way, is open to any of you. If any of you want to contribute data, or contribute insights to how to arrange data elements, make a digital cell line, or you know, contribute a segmented tissue, we would love to talk to you. And so just send me an email, and we'll bring you into the project. And we'd be really happy for it. Or if you want to start talking about saying, let's get all of our models to read digital cell lines so we can at least calibrate to the same data. And maybe output the snapshots so we can start doing ensembles. That's the kind of thing we need to start talking about. We have data bindings. We have XML schemas. So we kind of have the first steps going. So I think we're ready to start moving on that. So we'd love to talk with you. References, websites, in particular, mathcancer.org has most of our software. Multicell DS talks about our data standard. We'd love to have you guys visit, and we'd love your thoughts. And those are some challenges, so now we'll go solve them. So thank you.